Hi guys.
Yes, it is me. Welcome back to the FuzzFam channel. Welcome back to Benny on the Beat and the Patrol vlogs. I know you've been missing them.
Not really.
I am so sorry we've been gone because I've been sick. I've had the man flu, cold, cannoli virus. I don't even know what it is, but I've had something that's knocked me on my butt and I haven't been able to do any videos. I'm still sick. I'm still not over it. As you can tell, it's not my normal silky sexy voice. I got this
deep baritone sexy voice.
Thank you for the well wishes. I've been getting by. It's been hard. It's been difficult. The only medicine that's really been helping is M&Ms. So I've been working on... It's helping, I think. All right, we've wasted enough time being sick and eating M&Ms. We're gonna get right into this video, right into the heart pacing, pounding... What? We're gonna get right into the police action, but first, a word from this video's sponsor.
This video brought to you by Bernie Sanders.
Get off my lawn!
All right, first call we're gonna talk about, I was really, really bored because of the circumstances, so I had a few minutes to take some cell phone footage to augment the storytelling of what we're talking about. So let's jump right over to the first clip on that and set the stage for what we're talking about.
So I am up here freezing in this parking garage.
So far, so good.
All right, so here's what we're talking about. A dispatched call that very easily could have been thrown under the rug, nothing done with, called the person and told them, sorry, there's not much we can do. We tried, we came and went. You get the point, we could have just done nothing. Which, to be perfectly honest and fair, most of the time, might even have been what I would have done because we have other more important calls going on in the city. The problem she was having was she was in an apartment complex. She was getting continually woken up and disturbed by the sound of a car alarm going off in an apartment complex parking lot just across the street or down the street from her. And it wasn't once, twice, or three times. This apparently had been going on for days. She had exhausted all efforts of figuring out where it was coming from and what to do about it. So like most people, when they get to that point, who do you call? No, not the stupid fire department. No! You call the police because you have nowhere else to turn to.
Sorry, hang on, I gotta spit.
Ugh. Oh, more M&Ms.
Oh great, I don't have anything to wash them down with. Alright, we're gonna push on anyway. I probably have M&Ms in my teeth. Just don't look.
So she calls me and complains about this. I go into the area, and sure enough, I get there and I hear the car alarm. And I look over and I can see the building where it's coming from because I see the lights flashing on the car. It's on the second level of this parking structure. And it kind of appears that each time somebody opens the garage underneath to go into the parking structure, it sets off the car alarm. So I called her and I gave her the address of the complex. And I told her I'd go over in the morning and talk to someone in the leasing office or find a manager or something like that and make a complaint to them. Done deal, right? I helped her out. I went and found where the problem was, provided her the information so she could go and continue to solve her... There's nuts coming out of my mouth.
Dude.
You know what? That didn't sound... Not a word. Man, these videos are an absolute train wreck. I salute you guys for sitting through and putting up with this and watching them. I forgot what I was saying, but that seemed like a reasonable thing for her to go do to solve her own problem now that she had the information. She knew what complex she needed to go to so she could go talk to the right people. So I actually called and told her that, and she was grateful. She said, oh, great, thanks. That gets me farther ahead than I was before. We ended the call, and I was about to leave. As I was leaving, the car alarm got set off again. And I stopped. I paused, and I just thought, wait a minute. You know, I looked at the queue on calls. There were no priorities holding. There were no backs holding for anybody. And I said, you know what? I'm going to do more on this. I can do more. I can go in, and I can try to find the exact car, run the license plate, see if I can get an address, maybe even have a phone number to that person, and see if I can't get a hold of them directly to try to solve the problem. There's more I can do here.
So I had to follow in a car leaving the garage in order to get in. Now I have to wait for one to enter down below because that garage opening and shutting is what sets it off. And there's two cars here and I have no idea which one it is. And lo and behold, one of them is an Impala. Wow, that's a shocker. Another Impala causing people problems.
See, one of these two. That one, this one. This one's the Chevy Impala.
So I'm just sitting here watching through the grate, waiting for a car to pull in down here, because the garage down below, when it shuts, it seems like that's what triggers one of these two. And then I can figure out who owns it and try to solve the problem. Let them know their car is causing a nuisance.
So I figure my plan is foolproof. I just gotta wait and figure out which of these two cars it is. I need someone to enter the garage and set it off so that I can find out. So I'm sitting here freezing my canuggets off, waiting to figure out which car this is. And it only took 15 or 20 minutes, but eventually...
Oh. Nope. Never mind, false alarm. Honestly.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. I was waiting for it, but it totally scared the crap out of me when it went off. It was a lot louder than I thought it would be because I was right by it. And it wasn't even the Impala. Go figure.
Got you. I got you.
So I got the license plate off of the car, was able to wait for somebody to leave the garage so I could make my escape, get back to my car, and start doing some research to see what I can find to help this girl.
Oh yeah, there we go. That's super good video quality with the red light and the iPhone at night. So sorry about the video quality and audio. So I talked to some other people that live there. They were able to give me the name and phone number of the building manager. I got the number off the stall where the car was parked. So I called the gal that was having a hard time with this and gave her all that information. And she was beyond grateful. You could tell she was like physically relieved. This has apparently been plaguing her probably for the last 3 weeks. It's a really minor thing, but like I said, it's a big deal to the people that call. It's the biggest issue for them usually when they have to call the police. So it'd be really easy to have brushed that off. And if honestly we'd been busier, I would have had to, but glad I was able to figure something out for her and she was super, super grateful. I think I'll reward myself with some Chick-fil-A. Back to you, Studio Fuzz.
Yeah, thanks, iPhone Ben, appreciate it. Obviously not high-paced, crazy police action. This is nothing you'd ever see on Cops, but that's one of the greatest things about this job and part of the big reason a lot of us got into it is the people factor, to actually be able to get down and help people and be there for them. I know it sounds cheesy, but it's why a lot of us do what we do. And it was a good reminder to me. So that was a cool call. All right, next call. I had forgotten about this one. This is a little gem. You guys will get a kick out of this, I think. You know what? Instead of talking about this one, I'm just going to show you guys the dispatch call notes on this one. I'm going to find a little graphic somewhere on the internet, put it up here right now, and just paste the call notes. So you can read them yourself and imagine how you're gonna handle this call. This is a telephonic. This is calling the person about the issue. It's not going to their house. So here it is, and what would you do? I always knew Metallica, I knew they were trouble. I knew they were trouble. I mean, how do you have such hard-hitting, awesome, hard rock and not be involved in something like that? We do get these kind of calls all the time where there's obviously more of a mental health issue going on, and it's not like our dispatchers can just dismiss them. We've talked about this before in the videos. It depends on where you work. Some departments, some dispatch agencies have the latitude and the ability to screen those out and realize you're experiencing a mental health issue. Unless it's an emergency, we're not gonna have our officers respond to that. They're gonna handle it themselves. And some dispatchers are allowed to do that and they're very good at it. They screen the calls, they talk the person through it, they help actually satisfy their concern to some extent on the phone, and they don't ever involve the police. Where I work, they don't unfortunately have the ability or the permission to do that. So everything that comes in, regardless of how obvious it is that it's a legitimate problem, and sometimes when it's not real, it could still be a legitimate problem to somebody, right? Something that still needs help. Somebody still needs to respond. But there are obviously a lot of cases where that doesn't need to happen, but we still get the call and it's up to us to handle it as best we can. And stay away from hard rock, kids. Metallica, Slipknot, they're up to no good. Then we had a call of a fire assist. This was just a report of a homeless person behind a fenced area, behind a business in an alleyway, that started his own bonfire. So we get out there and sure enough, this guy had a pretty rip-roaring bonfire going, and the complainant was actually a restaurant owner in the area, and all the smoke from the fire was billowing into his restaurant, or I guess getting sucked down into his kitchen or something. So obviously he's not appreciating that. The interesting part about this one was this is a guy we had talked to before. Not me personally, but other officers were familiar with him. Very, very decent guy. Let's just call him Frank. Very, very decent guy. Frank is just trying to recover from drug use. He's slipping every now and then, but he's really trying. He's doing a good job. He has permission to be in this vacant lot by the owner, and he has a little RV that he camps out in, but he's got no heat, right? So he gets cold and wants to start a fire just for the purpose of getting warm. City ordinance does not allow you to have an open fire like that for the purpose of staying warm. However, I gotta give some kudos to the fire department here, one of the fire guys on scene, because he told us off to the side, you know, he can't have a warming fire, but if he was cooking anything, it's technically okay. I didn't even know that. So apparently if Frank just had a hot dog on a stick instead of just warming his hands, but obviously still getting warm, he would be in compliance. So now as an officer, what do you do with this information? Do you hide it from Frank for the benefit of the business owners? Or is Frank entitled to be doing whatever he wants if it's in compliance with the law? So it was my call, so I made the decision to have Frank come over by the fence where we could talk quietly, you know, so voices carry. I didn't necessarily want the complainant on this call to hear this, but we had a conversation and I didn't come right out and directly tell him, but I said, look, Frank, the law is such that it allows for certain things and doesn't allow for certain things. I don't remember how I said it, but something along the lines of the law actually allows you to have a small cooking fire. Kind of a read between the lines thing where I didn't try to lay it out for him and I guess sabotage the complainant, if you will, and set him up to have fires every night, you know, for the rest of his time that he's there. But at the same time, I felt Frank needed to know. I mean, if the law allows it, he should be able to do it. So I just gave him the information that hopefully he read between the lines and he does whatever with that.
She's burning good now.
Then we got a call to go find James Bond. James Bond was the suspect in this case. So these two women in an office building called, freaking out because some guy came in, ripped off the first aid kit off the side and said, I'm stealing this. And he emptied the first aid kit into his bag and took off. So anyway, I pulled up his information so I would know, since we're in an office building, who he is and try to see what he looks like in case we find him. And the picture was Daniel Craig. I was fully expecting the appearance of somebody else, just my preconceived notions when I'm picturing this. But it was this very, very good looking spy. That's who the picture was. That's kind of what came up. It was almost like a lookalike. So, obviously no problem identifying him, assuming that he was in good enough condition that he looked similar to his picture. So we searched through the building, unfortunately couldn't find him, but we talked to the women, made them feel safe, took a report, escorted them to their cars so they could get out of there, and whatever. I don't know whatever happened with that case, but the funny part on this one is when we got out to our cars, my partner was in an old loaner Chevy Impala, and it was parked right next to my nice new Explorer. So I was talking with him about why he was in this car, because it was even older than most of the Chevy Impalas. And I felt really bad because he told me that his car had broken down, an Impala, shocker, and it had so many problems that the shops folks told him, look, we're actually going to sell your car at auction. You're gonna get a new car. I can testify to you as to the thrill and joy that comes into the human soul when you hear those words and you know that you will soon not have an Impala in your life. So I know the joy that he was experiencing, and within the next hour he got another call saying, actually, never mind, we're gonna fix yours, give it a couple weeks and you'll have it back.
No. I refuse. No.
A couple of weeks in this loaner Impala, which, by the way, he had almost had to have towed because it was having so many problems and breaking on him. I am telling you guys, I am not the only one that has gone through this trauma. There are many, many officers. It's not like I'm hard on cars. You guys know this. I preach about it all the time, but I'm telling you, it's the worst cop car ever made. So condolences to my partner on that one. Not like he's watching, but hang in there, buddy. Hang in there. A brighter Impala-free day is coming. Just might not be coming for a year or two. That sucks. Whoa. Invasion, Penny on the beat. Hey, come here. Look, everybody. Say hi to everybody, Penny.
Say hi to everybody.
Make my video get more views. The cuteness. The cuteness.
Yes. Kisses. You want my M&Ms? That's what you want, huh? You can't have my M&Ms.
Let's look at some comments from you guys last week. Did I say last week? It was more than a week ago. Whenever the last patrol vlog was, we're gonna look at a few comments from that video. Austin Moore Official. Dude, I love your videos. I want to be a police officer. Any tips? Also, does the police academy actually tase you with a taser or something else? Or also, can you buy one? If you get tased in the police academy, it's only with the taser. They don't tase you with anything other than the taser. They don't hook you up to the electrical socket or anything like that. Yeah, you can buy tasers, not police ones. The police ones are for law enforcement only. They operate a little bit differently, different amperage, different time cycle on them, but you can buy civilian tasers. And Austin, it depends on the police academy. Some police academies will run you through the taser and OC spray, some won't. Some departments will have you do it when you get on with them. They'll have their own training people put you through it, but it just depends. As far as tips, just make sure you're subscribed to the FuzzFam channel. Watch every video that we put out, even the ones that have nothing to do with law enforcement. It'll make you a better, more rounded person. More rounded? Gosh dang it. I'm not talking about getting fatter. Shot myself in the foot on that one. Let's move on. Matthew Hall. I've seen paramedics and firefighters have channels where they have cameras on the vehicle vlogging their day. Is that anything you've considered or talked to command about? It's a good question, Matthew. We get this all the time. People want to see more on the job footage. I mean, I've showed you little snippets of things like today's video with the cell phone. I really can't do anything more than that. It's in policy. We can't record on. It's because you can't take a camera to work, record what you're doing, put it on YouTube, and be making money off the video on YouTube as well as making money on the job. It's kind of like a double dipping conflict of interest type thing. It's one reason why most departments have policy that you can't do that, not to mention the liability of using your own camera and putting who knows what onto the internet. So at this point, unfortunately, no, it's not something that I can do. These videos represent the farthest I can really push sharing stuff from the job and video clips here and there to augment them. I do the best I can with that. And who knows, you know, maybe down the road, but as of right now, that's the way it is. Kenneth Nichols filmed some videos sitting in the patrol car. See, now that I can do. If I'm not on duty, I can sit in my car and film all day long. In fact, we've done that in the past. So you guys want to see more of that instead of me sitting in here, is what you're saying? I can do that. The only thing that's nice about down here is I've got this studio quality mic.
Hey.
And I've got some sound panels and stuff. You guys probably don't even realize it, but if you switch the audio from this is what it sounds like on this camera, back to this is what it sounds like for the rest of the video, you can see why I do it in here. Better audio quality. A Google user, what's your favorite cruiser of all time? Maybe a list of your most favorite to least favorite and why would be a cool video. Will, that is actually a really good idea for a video. Will, I officially give you credit right now for the idea for that. I think I'm gonna make a video about that. No guarantees as to when it will be. Probably sometime early spring 2021 or maybe into 2022 at the pace that I go. I'll try to make it sooner than that, but that's a good idea for a video. I will just jump to the answer and tell you though, I think it's probably the Crown Vic. I think the Crown Vic's the best car I've ever had. But I'll do a video explaining in detail why and we'll have some fun with that. Thanks for the recommendation. Shane Trahan, do police departments generally pay hourly with overtime or salary pay? How are you paid, FuzzFam? I'm paid with the appreciation of the citizens that I serve.
Pig.
Also hourly. With overtime. Yes, we can get overtime and we're paid hourly. It's not salary. Once you get to command level or you're a supervisor, you get high enough in the ranks, it switches over to a salary position in a lot of departments. But the rank and file, such as I, it is hourly. Jeremy Greenwood. Oh, great. Jeremy always has the best comments. I've noticed that you always seem to be the backup and never the primary. We trying to skip out on paperwork now, too, on top of not actually doing traffic stops?
Greenwood.
I don't know what you're talking about, Greenwood. Not true. What at all? Moving on. Grassroot Digital. I've got a question. Okay. What tools would you recommend for new officers to carry to make the job easier, both on the odd side of things and the tactical side of things? Well, my tactical level is, you know what? One of the best things, I will tell you this. I carry what we used to call the Z tool. Now there's a few different things that actually fit into that category of what they call the Z tool. But I'm talking about a spring loaded pin that breaks windows. You will at some point in your career as a police officer need to get into a car window to help somebody or break a window. And the first thing a lot of people think of is the asp or the baton. Whoosh, they open that bad boy and they think that they're gonna break into a window with that. You guys that are cops or you've seen this, you know what happens. It's the window bounces off, sometimes bounces off right into you and hit yourself with it. Those things do not break windows as well as you think they would. As far as tools, honestly, your department's gonna provide you most of the tools that you need. I will say the radio mic earpiece that I have, that's something that certain officers are issued in our department. I had to kind of grovel and work the system to get mine. It's a tool that I really like for tactical reasons. Nobody can hear the radio transmission. I did a video, my patrol vest video. If you haven't seen that one, I'll throw a link up to it right here. And we talk about that in there. And you wouldn't believe all the questions I get on the daily from people wanting to know more about that earpiece. In fact, I need to make my own video. A video just about that earpiece and talk about it. Good question though. Caleb Bowman, don't put the cruiser through the car wash. What? Okay, thanks, Kayla. Do you suggest going to the academy on your own or do so through your agency if you tend to get hired on with? Well, Kayla, if you have an agency you want to work with that they will sponsor you or put you through and pay for you to do that, I would do that all day long if you can get hired on and do that. It used to be back when I started that there was enough competition. It's not the same anymore, honestly, but there used to be enough competition for this job that if you self-sponsored, which is what I did, it told employers, look, I'm serious enough about this. I, on my own initiative, got my training and paid for it out of pocket myself. Employers like to see that, and it was a good benefit to me when I was applying for agencies. These days, there's not as much interest in getting into law enforcement, so departments are actually having to do things like sponsor people through in order to actually get qualified candidates. I want to tell you guys how much I was going to say something really meaningful there. I don't know what it was. But look, we appreciate you guys being here. Thank you for being subscribed to the channel. If you guys enjoy these videos, you get something out of it, let us know by leaving a like down below for the YouTube algorithm. Did I say algorithm? I might be having a stroke. We better end the video. I love you guys. We'll see you next time. Everybody have a great week. Let's level up. Pedal to the metal when I play the cut. Doing double time like double dust. Lay a dime a dozen so I double up. These late nights finna pay y'all. That's a fire hat. I swear and promise, I will never wear that hat.